We're good.
If anyone would take their seats, we'll get our service started this morning. Welcome everyone to our service this morning and this last day of January 2021. To start us off in our frame of mind of worshiping our Lord and Savior, I'd like to read the first portion out of John chapter 17. After Jesus said this, he looked toward heaven and prayed, Father, the time has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all men, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given to him. Now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory that I had with you before the world began. Then Jesus prays for his disciples. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now they know everything you have given me comes from you. For I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and that they believe that you sent me. I pray for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and you have is mine. The glory has come to me through them, and I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you, Holy Father. Protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one with you as we are one.
Good morning, everybody. As you can see, I'm your song leader again, backed by popular demand. Actually, nobody else would do it. We'll have two songs and then I'll open in prayer. So song number two. Ready?
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of our love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Praise thee, O God, for thy spirit.
Especially, Father, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for his coming to earth to be the sacrifice for our sin. Thank you for your plan of salvation, the grace that you grant us. Thank you for the blood that Jesus shed on the cross. Thank you again, Father, for all the blessings you've given to us. And we pray that you'll watch over us this day. We pray in Jesus' name.
Next song will precede our Lord's take. 791.
On bended knee I come, with a humble heart I come, bowing down.
tonight we are studying 2 Thessalonians. And by the way, we are having very good discussions in those classes. So if you're not logging in with us, I urge everyone to do that. It's a uplifting experience. But in 2 Thessalonians, verse 7, we came across a verse that says, this will happen when Jesus is revealed from heaven in blazing fire with his powerful angels. And I got to thinking about that verse, and I got to thinking about what that means, that Jesus is revealed. And many times in Scripture, we see that word revealed. The Greek word for that word is apokalypso. Don't hold me to that enunciation of it, but I think that's the way you pronounce it. And that word is, as we know in a transliterated version, apocalypse. So, and that's what that verse is actually talking about when Jesus comes back. But then I got thinking that that word revealed is used many other times in the Scripture. Throughout the New Testament, actually. And actually in the portion that I read this morning already, in John 17, it says, I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. And if you think about Jesus' mission and what the book of Revelation really is all about, it's about revealing God to us. And I'd like to read this last portion of John 17 also, as Jesus continues to pray to the Father. The first portion, he prays about himself. The second portion, he prays about his direct disciples, the apostles, I believe. And this portion, he's praying about all believers. For them, I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. Verse 20. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me, and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them, you in me. May they be brought to complete unity, to let the world know that you sent me. I have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given to me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me, because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know you, know that you have sent me. I have revealed you to them, and you will continue to make you known, in order that the love you have for me may be theirs, and that I myself may be in them. And then I got to thinking about what Jesus' ministry was all about. And that's where this word reveal comes up many times. Because Jesus came here to seek and save the lost, obviously. But he also came here to bring God to them as well as bring them to God. To reveal God as he is in his glory, as he is in the Father, Son, and the Spirit. Previously, all that was, as the New Testament says, a mystery to people because they didn't know any of that. But the revelation that God wants us to know is who he is through the Father, Son, and the Spirit, and the fact that he loves us. He wants to lay his cards on the table so that we may know him in unity and in love. And that knowing him, as Ephesians chapter 2, what that really means is to be in him in unity. And that's what he seeks. He seeks not just for us to live in the mansion. He seeks, really, for us to be one with him, one with Jesus, one with the Father, and one with the Holy Spirit. Because Jesus came, to give us glory. And through that glory, we are brought to him as one. And that's what his resurrection was all about, actually. The disciples, the apostles, I don't think really understood what Jesus was until that resurrection came about. And then they knew and they saw God really more fully and understand him more completely. Let's pray together. Father, we're so grateful for this time that we can come to think about your gift to us, to understand what he means to us, who he is, and his fullness of glory, Father, even though we know that we cannot fully understand it, but we can seek to be in him always as we're raised up out of the quagmire of our sins, as he has done for us, that we are brought to him, and that Jesus indeed has given us this chance to be one with God. What an awesome thought that is. Help us, Father, to contemplate these things. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. for what God has given us. Because all good things come from Him. And that we too are called to give back that which He has blessed us with. Pray with me, please. Father, we're so grateful for this time that we can raise our hearts and our minds to You. And as this part of our service, we really would like to thank You, Father, for all the blessings that You have given us. Help us, Father, to be people that are truly thankful and bring that thanks with us always. Help us to be generous to those in need. Help us to understand serving others is the way to be glorified in Your sight, Father, that we, as a servant, as Jesus was, that is what we strive to be also. We're thankful for those blessings, as we said, in Jesus' name, amen.
After this song, we will have our lesson. Ready?
Oh God, You are my God, and I will ever praise You. Oh God, You are my God, and I will ever praise You. I will seek You in the morning, and I will learn to walk in Your way.
Sure, if you can see the picture real well, but nope. Just for you, Joseph. Treasures, single word. Actually, it was supposed to be part of the scripture up there. We have this treasure in jars of clay. We're going to read the whole thing in a second, but let me get the Bible out. What are treasures, right? And of course, we all know the parable. I believe in Matthew, I think it's Matthew chapter 6. And that's where, you know, the individual goes out and he's digging in the field and he finds this treasure and goes and sells everything he has to even buy the field to take ownership of the treasure. And of course there's another one, I think when he finds the pearls, the great pearls, and so forth. Anyway, that's treasure, something really special, something very important. This is, so now, my scripture reading, if I get there. Oh, I think I can take that off. Is in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, but actually I'm going to start in verse 6. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. And there's more, but we'll save that for later. Let me see if I can get this to work. All right, so if we'll go to the next slide, Alan. We have a raft of scriptures that we'll be covering today in the lesson. And you see that list there. So as we go through, I'll be hitting on those. So, what is a jar? And specifically in our case here, what is a jar of clay? So, jars are what? Vessels, right? It's something that's designed, right, for a specific purpose. And then you say, well, what's it made of? Well, in this case, you know, back in Jesus' time, these jars that they used, what kind of things were stored in the jars? And one of the ones that first comes to my mind is, right, the alabaster and, you know, this perfume, this very expensive perfume is stored in this jar. And actually, to get to it, you had to actually break it, right? You had to break the top off to get to this. So, but what are they made of? What is this jar made of that's holding such a precious perfume or precious treasure, right? Well, it's made out of common materials, right? It's just made out of clay. It's just made out of dirt, if you will. You know, dirt, a little bit of water, right? And they do. But then, what happens? How do we make it, right? You take that clay, whatever, and you shape it into whatever it is that you're going to make. I made a clay jar once. Didn't turn out so well, right? It didn't look that. I mean, there's many ways, right? You can do it with, Barry and I got into making ceramics when we were first into the Air Force, you know, and you have these molds, and you can pour it into a mold, and leave the clay set there, and then you pour after a while, you pour out the remaining liquid, and it has a thick coating on the outer portion, which is this clay mug, or cup, or whatever it was, or bowl. But in its green state, right, it's really, really super fragile. Really not what you can do with it, right? You have to, well, you go ahead and you clean it up a little bit, and you have these tools, and you can shape and things, and you can clean up some of the flaws, and you make it look really good. But then what do you have to do? You have to fire it, right? You have to refine it in the fire to make it strong, to bond, and it really gets a tight, tight bond so that it can be held together. But even at that state, it looks okay, but it's just white, right? And it's got the shapes and everything, but it doesn't have character, if you will, yet at that point. It has some amount of character, but you want to do something more. So then what we would do is we would sit there and paint, right? You sit there and you go and you paint different portions on it, so you give it color and you give it more character, and you give it something that makes it more attractive and more appealing. And you take that and you fire it again. Put it in the kiln at hot temperature, cooks it, and it also has like a glaze, right? And the glaze smooths it over and gives it protection. But there's another thing still about it. And of course, having worked in and with ceramic materials, one of the things you know if you work in ceramics is that in compression, they're very, very strong. They can take tremendous load. And we were looking at ceramic bearings and, you know, ceramic balls, and man, they have a very, very long life. The wear life is very long. So they can, you know, and so the space shuttle, one of the problems they had in the engines was that the original metal balls in the ball bearings would wear down. And at the end of a mission, actually, they would have to rebuild the engine. They would pull the ball bearings. bearings out, and actually the balls would kind of drop out. They had worn so much in that liquid oxygen environment that they would actually have reduced their size. So they went to a ceramic ball. Right? So it's got good wear life, very good in compression. But you know, if you have a little bitty micro flaw, micro crack inside that material, in tension, it's super weak. It'll pop. You know, it'll pop, it'll crack, it'll break apart. Right? And so that's what a jar of clay is going to be, very fragile. Good in compression, but as soon as you know, if you drop it, I don't know. Okay, so how many have seen the movie The Fifth Element? Okay, all right. Now there's a scene in the movie, all right, where Gary Oldman or Zork, Mr. Zork, right, and the priest comes in for the fifth element, and Gary Oldman or Mr. Zork says, you know, he's talking about this life that you're talking about, this stability that you're talking about. See, I'm going to bring a little chaos into the world. And he said, you see this glass? And he said, you see, if I push it off the edge of the table, see how it falls to the floor and it shatters into 1,000 pieces. Right? So that's what this fragile jar is that holds this treasure. And if you take a look at the parallels, though, in the passage, we are that jar of clay, right? We're made from the earth, and we are that treasure, but we are also that jar of clay. And what does that mean? Well, we're common. We're common people, right? There's many varieties of us. We get tired, mentally and physically. We're subject to illness, right? COVID, we know, heart disease, cancer, many of these things, and they can take us down. And as we see with COVID, the death toll can be huge. So we are fragile. We as a human are fragile. And as we age, of course, we begin to show our cracks. Some of us have little crow feet. Some of us maybe turn white. But we, too, if we get pushed too hard off the edge of the table, you know, mentally and physically, we too can shatter into pieces. So, but what is it, this treasure that we carry within us? Right? And that's where we do go back to the scripture that I read earlier, right? And it says, the light of God, that's the treasure within us. It's the light of God. Okay? And that treasure is something super valuable. It's of great worth. It's precious and highly prized. You know, and God considers us worthy to hold that treasure within us as fragile as we are. So we go to some scriptures here, Exodus in chapter 19. And it said, then Moses went up to God, and the Lord called him from the mountain and said, this is what you are to say to the descendants of Jacob, and what you are to tell the people of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did to Egypt, and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations, you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. And then in Deuteronomy chapter 7 and verse 6, for you are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you out of all the peoples on the face of the earth to be his people, his treasured possession. And in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession. So, several of the items that have come out of that we just read is we're holy. If holy, as we've talked about in many of our classes, means to be set apart or exalted or worthy of complete devotion as one who is perfect in goodness and righteousness. That's hard to believe, isn't it? That God considers us holy with our flaws, with our weaknesses, with the sins that we do, yet he still considers us worthy of complete devotion, one who is perfect in goodness and righteousness. And God has chosen each of us out of all the peoples of the earth to be his treasured possession, to be exalted, to be worthy of devotion, to be perfect in goodness and righteousness. But you know, this holiness is not something that is inherent in us. We are only holy because of our relationship to Christ. This holiness is imputed to us, it's granted to us by God when we accept him and when we obey his commandments. And then we can become righteous. And in Romans chapter 3, it talks about our righteousness. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given to us through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. So we're righteous not because of our nature, but because of Christ. Christ in us. The light of God, Christ, is in us. That's what our treasure is. And then in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 30, because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God. That is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. And in Philippians chapter 3, and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. And as we've talked about before, our faith requires action. And that action is as we obey God and we do his commands. Right? And again, all this treasure, this holiness, this righteousness, this light of God, Christ in us, is held in a jar of clay. Common material, common people, yet of great value. But how do we, as fragile beings, survive? Well, we can go to some of Paul's lessons to us, and some of the things that Paul has told us through his letters. For example, in 2 Corinthians 4, right? And 7 and following, you know, we had read earlier about the light of God. He said, but first he says, well, let me go here, let me open it up. Read the whole thing. But we have, and starting in verse 7, but we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. Now, we are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our bodies. Whoop. Hey, I need a new phone. Okay. So, first off, Paul says he's hard-pressed. Now, how many, okay, we're going back to the movies, right? How many have seen the movie Star Wars? Right? Everybody's, well, I won't say everybody. Let's say most of us have seen Star Wars. So, anyway, in that movie, the first one, right? They're down in the trash compactor or the trash thing on the starship, right? Whatever. And what's happening? The sides are coming in, right? They're coming in slowly. And what are they trying to do? They're hollering out there, you know, R2, you know? He's got the little microphone thing, and Luke is hollering to R2 and to C-3PO to, you know, stop the sides from coming in to crush them, right? And
then this little monster thing comes up and grabs Luke and draws him under the water. It's almost like a boa. It's going to crush the life out of him, right? So Paul says he's hard-pressed on every side, but he's not crushed. And what happens? I mean, they're trying everything on their own, right? They're putting up a bar across the thing between them, and it just kind of crumples it, right? They're doing what they can to try to save themselves. It's someone outside them who actually saved them. It is somebody outside us who's going to save us. It is God who's going to save us, not a robot, right? He said he's hard-pressed but not crushed. Indicates that the pressure that Paul was under, right, never got to the point where he felt he had no escape or no way out. Right? God always gives us a way out. God is always there, whether we recognize it or not. He says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind, and God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. So God is faithful. Now, second, Paul says he's perplexed, right? But not in despair. So he's at a loss, maybe, for how to act. But he's not at a complete and total utter loss. He's not in despair, right? He's not in extreme despair. He may not have been sure about how to proceed, but he never went off the deep end, right? And that's where sometimes they say, you know, you just need to pray to God and say, give me the words, you know? And that's what happened often with the apostles, right? As they were going about, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit within was what enabled them to be able to speak and to present God's word. Paul himself was new to preaching. Yes, he was a great understudy. Yes, he knew the law from the Jews. But was he a preacher? Was he out there? No, he wasn't. But now, and he had no template. He had to learn as he went. Now, it says also, he said, he was persecuted, but not abandoned. You see, and this is where, you know, he was pursued. He was hunted down. He was tracked by those. Everywhere he went, people would, you know, if he went from Berea to Athens, or he went from Thessalonica, rather, down to, I think, to Berea, or, you know, missionary thing. I'm getting a lot of sequence, but that's okay. But they tracked him, and they would, you know, stir up trouble for him through hostile intent. But through it all, God never abandoned him. The idea here is that God did not leave Paul behind or in the lurch. For those that were trying to hurt him, for them to succeed. And finally, he says he was struck down by the enemy, but not destroyed. And we know Paul was stoned, left for dead, yet he survived through the power of God. He was not destroyed. All of this that was pushed on him did not overcome him. Why? Because God was with him. God will always be with us. So we can be a little like Paul, right? But we are jars of clay. We're fragile. At times, we're weak, and we succumb to temptation. We got to remember, Paul's telling us in Corinthians, no temptation can overcome us. God will give us a way out. We have to rely on him and strengthen ourselves. At times, we do get tired, and we can break. But you have to rely on the power of God, because he is using us, our fragile people, to carry out his mission. So there will be no mistake as to whose power is behind us, because our weakness, we can see it as we look at ourselves truly. We can see we are weak. Where does the power come from? It doesn't come from us. It comes from within. For the within us, who is the light of God, who is Christ, who is the Holy Spirit. And this power can turn people's lives upside down, even though it is stored in our fragile vessel. So, that all-surpassing power of God, we can see it. We may be hard-pressed and overwhelmed, but we will not be crushed if we have faith and rely on God's all-surpassing power. We may be perplexed and at a loss, but not in despair. We're not without hope. God will provide the the will, the path, and the way. We may be persecuted, but we will never be abandoned, for we are God's treasured possession. He treasures us greatly. So we can go to the last slide. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. So remember, each of us are fragile. Each of us have our own weaknesses. But each of us also has the power of God within us. It's important for each of us to recognize the fragility of life, the fragility of those around us, that we might have a little more compassion maybe in our hearts, a little care, to recognize that while I might be strong today, maybe I need help tomorrow. And so someone in need of help today, we should reach out, we should encourage, we should strengthen, we should treat them just like God does, as a treasured vessel that is super important, that He has given us holiness, He has given us righteousness. So if you have a need today, if you have something you want to come forward with, you have a need, you feel fragile, you feel weak, you feel tired mentally or physically, let us know as we stand and sing the song of invitation.
Thank you, Jen.
This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. Treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friends like you. If heaven is not my home, then Lord, what would I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. They're all expecting me, and that's one thing I know. My Savior pardoned me, and now I upward go. I know He'll take me through, though I am weak and poor, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friends like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Just up in glory land we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand are shouting in glory. Back from heaven's shore, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
The announcements for today, relatively slim, but keep your calendars open for July 18th, that week, plus I think the second week. Right now we'll probably still need to communicate, hopefully everything will still go up with the Sojourners in July, that they will be here and help us as we strive to reach out and share God's word with those around us. Ladies class, Thursday morning, February 4th at the building, 10 a.m. So continue, the ladies are regularly meeting. As a matter of fact, I think the ladies, with a little help from Alan, also clean the sidewalks for us this Thursday. So thank you for those that came out and do that. And I see that it looks like we're gonna get a fair amount of snow this week as well. So we might have to have the ladies help again. I think I'll be skiing, okay?
Well, it's Wednesday, because the storm is coming Tuesday into Wednesday morning. So, you know, hey, you got to go when the powder's good. Those are pretty much it. A couple of birthdays coming up. Check your bulletin for that. If you do have prayer requests and so on, please do send them to Beth. She'll get them into the bulletin. And if you have issues that are on there that you think have been taken care of, and so you see that there are things on there that maybe can be taken off the list, you know, it'd be also good to, you know, let us know that, hey, maybe as a follow-up, say, hey, you know, God has answered our prayers, and this individual has, you know, has recovered or whatever. But it'll be good to know that. A few of the things that we have on here are, let's see, I assume Nate.
He's wonderful.
Okay, Nate's great. Perfect. I haven't had a chance to talk to the Garretts here lately, but I think things are going well. I know Michelle has a job. I know Eve has been, she's on the varsity basketball team. Things are going well there. I see here, and the Terry family, looks like everybody's going well there. Bob and Penny are doing well. Contrell.
They're okay.
They're okay, because you got a note here that says that they need to be COVID tested.
They were. It's negative.
Everything's good?
Yeah.
Very good. Bill Fisk is undergoing liver transplant. I think we
have, he did have it.
He did have it.
Yeah.
Okay, so continue to pray for his recovery. Bill Paradowski, another radiation treatment, things are going on. Continue to pray for Bill. We do want to add to the list, and as Bev has done that, maybe some longer-term health issues for Mary, and continue to pray for her that all will go well, that God will be in our lives. If there are no further announcements, then if you will join with me, we'll go to our Father in prayer. Be dismissed. Our God and Father in heaven, we thank you so very much that you consider us a treasure, that within us we can have Jesus in our lives. We can have your light, the light of life in us, and your Holy Spirit. Father, it's just amazing that you consider us who are weak, who are fragile, to be a treasure. We just thank you so much that you do make us your treasured possession. Father, as we go about this week, we do pray for our body here. We do pray that you would watch over us, that for those that are ill, that you would take care of them and work with the doctors and heal them, if that be your will. Father, we also pray as a body here that you would give us wisdom to do those things that will bring glory to you, that will save souls. And Father, that as we look from what we covered last week in our planning session and our conversation about where we as a body are to head, we pray that if it be your will, that you bring someone to us, lead us to someone. And we pray about this daily and weekly, Father, that we would do the right thing and that you will bless us through whomever you can send to us, but give us the wisdom to see the opportunities that you put before us, that we'll take advantage of them and do those things that will bring glory to you. Father, we pray for our nation, we pray for our leaders, we pray for all of those who are on the front lines that are doing your will as well. For we ask all this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, this is off. This had fallen, so I guess we were.